Nein, Fast and Nice. Good morning to you, some chips and oak. Thank you for coming tonight. It's lovely to see so many of you here, particularly given the horrible, horrible weather out there. This is the third lecture in the University College Isle of Man History and Heritage Public Lecture Series. Bit of a mouthful. And I'm absolutely delighted to welcome Professor Howard Williams from the University of Chester. Professor Williams has the dubious pleasure of being the link tutor between the Department of History and Archaeology at the University of Chester and our History and Heritage degree here at UCM, which is validated by the University of Chester. And so he is, I think, quite happily becoming a frequent visitor to the Isle of Man. Professor Williams is a professor of archaeology, as you may have gathered, and his research focuses primarily on death, burial and commemoration, particularly in the early Middle Ages. He's published widely on the areas and also publishes a regular blog post about his archaeological adventures on his website Archaeodeath. Well worth having a look at, and I have no doubt that his adventures on the Isle of Man will soon be making an appearance on his blog. For the past 5 years, Professor Williams has also been the editor of the Archaeological Journal, a leading national journal published by the Royal Archaeological Institute. And earlier this year, on his last visit to the island, he very kindly talked to us about some of his current research on the depiction of smiths on Viking-Age sculpture and how we might interpret them. And I'm really pleased that he's agreed to come back this evening and talk to us about watchful warriors on Viking-Age sculpture and what these warriors might actually represent. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Katrina, and good evening, everybody. How are you? All right? Good to see you. Lovely to be back. Twice in a year might seem twice too much, especially as he just drops the controller. Here we are. Okay. Twice too much. But I will be discussing Viking Age material again, but very different themes, I think, to what I discussed last time. Although there will be some overlap in terms of monuments and theoretical contexts in which I'll be discussing it. What I want to do over the next 45 minutes is introduce you to three case studies that try to explore aspects of why figural sculpture was a powerful force in 10th and early 11th century society as a way of communicating ideas about the person, about what it is to be a person, and particular kinds of person. In this case, we're going to be talking about warriors or martial figures. And suggesting that these figures, when depicted on stone and originally perhaps coloured in striking fashions, would have been about communicating between the living and the dead and making important statements for the living about the dead. And I want to do that through these three case studies, and I'll take them sequentially and try to show you what the evidence might be telling us. Because any book on the Vikings will have some of these images within it. In particular, this gent on the right here from Middleton in Yorkshire. Every book, I think, every glossy book on the Viking world, on Viking and Viking Britain and Ireland, will somewhere in its pages contain at least one or more photographs of this 10th century figure. And he tends to be called a warrior or a lord because, as you can pick out, and we'll discuss some of the features, there are a series of weapons around this figure. But beyond that, little gets said about this particular individual. He is not part of a mythological scene or a legendary scene. It's very difficult. There's no text attached to it to tell us whether this is a portrait. It's enigmatic. And yet again and again it's reeled out as an example of what a warrior may have looked like in the 10th century. So I want to discuss that as one example, and I'll move on to some other examples. And I suppose the key idea, the question behind this talk is, how do we study Viking Age stone monuments? What are the kind of questions we want this material to tell us? And this is an important question. It's an interdisciplinary question, and it's a question that is as applicable to the north of Scotland as to southwest England, to Western Ireland, and to the Isle of Man. It's a question that it could be applied in new and fresh, with new and fresh answers to it, to a lot of the Manx material, which has been well studied, but I think there are new questions coming to the fore about how we, what we want to know about stone sculpture. Who was carving it, why it was carved, why it was carved in the way it was carved, and why it was placed where it was. And this is a topic that I addressed in a book that came out 12 months ago, an edited collection, with two of my colleagues from Chester, Giant Curtain and Megan Gondek, looking at early medieval stone monuments and picking out three particular themes. What we call the materiality of stone, and this is a theme that's come to the fore with a range of other researchers and a Glasgow EAA conference session dedicated to looking at, in particular, the materiality of monuments, how stone was used, what properties it had, and how that was manipulated. The biography of monuments, how they are used over time, how they have often many different phases of activity written onto them, and their landscape context. And while many of these stones have been dislocated and moved around, as with many of your Manx stones, I don't think any in their original landscape situation, we can only guess or suggest where they may have originally been, we can sometimes talk about spatial arranged patterns of where they're located and how they may have been arranged. And so archaeologists in particular can talk about the discoveries and the context of those discoveries. New early medieval carved stones are being found all the time. You may have caught the discovery program with Durham University's excavations at Lindisfarne producing some of the new early medieval name stones recently, and that was on Digging for Britain TV program. So you'll be aware that we're still finding these fragments and discovering them, but we can study their context. We can apply new methods of analysis to these stones, laser scanning and RTI, new ways of looking at the subtle traces in different lights and with different techniques, study their wear. But it's in particular these last three themes that we can take on new approaches and apply them to these monuments. Look at how these monuments were placed in the landscape or placed in architectural spaces. Their biographies of use and reuse, and it's in this lecture I want to focus on their materiality, how they impacted on the senses of early medieval people, how striking they were. And that's often a challenge, because today they look like bare stone, but they once would have been vibrantly coloured. And one of the themes I've been playing with and thinking through in a lot of my work in recent years is this idea of ocular agency, the power of being seen. These monuments were prominent in the landscape often, or within particular church settings, so they were intended to be seen and to be engaged with through vision, but also perhaps with other senses. But also sometimes they almost had an animated quality of their own that made them almost like seeing entities themselves. They looked back at you. And particularly with figural forms, that may sound a bit scary. We always talk about portraits looking back at you. I think this had a powerful effect on early medieval people in terms of how they thought about these monuments. So crosses and other stone sculpture could operate as landmarks. They could be memorials. But what I'm also suggesting is they could be sentinels. They could be set in places to witness events, to be living, animated entities that were part of the audience of any ceremonies and rituals being conducted by early medieval people, to make an utterance there, to swear an oath in the presence of a cross was not doing so in the presence of an inanimate physical object. It was being in the presence of God. And not only that the particular saints depicted or the particular scenes depicted might prompt or enhance that sense of being in the presence of a particular witness. And certainly the figural art on some of the most famous early medieval stone sculpture suggests that this idea of knowledge acquisition, of a sense of faith created by witnesses, and as a stone that's witnessing the acts taking place around it, the performances taking place of it. And this is overt in some of the elements of the famous Rothwell monument from Dumfriesshire, where not only do you have the dream of the rude poem going around the sides in runic text, which speaks in the first person about the cross witnessing Christ's crucifixion, but of course you have the inhabited vine scroll, which has been interpreted
in various ways, but might is in general sense a metaphor for the consumption of the true vine of Christ. So you have this sense of beasts nibbling away in the process of acquiring salvation. Just as the beasts in the desert have their feet of Christ upon their muzzles, their paws are crossed, their ears are pricked, listening, sensing, watching Christ. So this idea that the cross depicts figures that are in the act of watching back and figures that are in the act of acquiring knowledge. And this is, I think, an important theme for early medieval sculpture that can be also taken through to the Viking Age, to the 9th to 11th century sculpture, where we see many changes in the sculpture in these islands, including the Isle of Man. And I put in an obligatory Isle Manx monument here for you. So here's Sigurd on his finger-licking Kentucky Fried Dragon. The part of the story of Sigurd is that he roasts the dragon's heart over the flames and then licks the fingers, and suddenly he can understand what these rather gigantic birds are saying to him. And I suppose my point with this image is to give you a sense that those themes of witnessing and being a witness might apply to these scenes too. Scenes that are usually seen as depictions of a story, but I think are as much about showing individuals, in this case a legendary warrior, in the act of acquiring knowledge and in the act of having that knowledge transferred to him through his senses. He's got his fingers in his mouth. He's taken the juices from the roasted dragon's heart, and he's learning the truth of his own future. He's being warned by the birds that his foster father, Regan, is going to kill him, and so he must act first. So these birds are giving him information. So he's on the cross, on this cross, being depicted. He's a legendary figure. That story tells us about the Viking and the insular world's connections in the 10th and 11th century. And that is interesting, and scholars are focused on that. But I think it also tells us about this theme of crosses depicting figures in the act of acquiring knowledge. Knowledge of Christ. And in this case, this may be an analogue for a Christian teaching, or in this case, the acquisition of knowledge to save themselves from very immediate peril in a corporal sense. Now, the Viking Age material, we see many more carved stones. We also see many more sites where we have carved stones. And in the Isle of Man, we see that very clearly, that the Viking Age is an eruption of new kinds of ornament, new kinds of memorial, and many more sites where these stones have been discovered. And this applies to northern England and southern Scotland too. But one of the key things that's often been linked as distinctive of the Viking Age and seen as somehow something exclusively Viking is that we see many more warriors. Many more martial figures, and some of these have been linked to mythological scenes. So while Sigurd, in this particular scene, it doesn't seem to be holding a weapon, he's busy doing other things with his hands, you get a sense that this is a martial figure. It's someone that's linked to stories that predate Christianity. But I'm suggesting that this is to do with sensory agency of the figures, and this is a theme we see already in Christian art, the acquisition of knowledge. And I think that theme helps us to understand my three case studies, and I'm going to take them each in turn. And the first one is how this theme of watching and witnessing helps us to understand the material context of one monument called Middleton II. Now, Middleton in Yorkshire has a series of very distinctive small grey slabs, or grey stones, that are thought to be burial markers. We don't have any in situ to confirm that they were used to mark graves, but they're small, diminutive, circle-headed crosses with panel scenes down each side. So this is Middleton 1, and this is the front and back of the same stone. And you have a very sort of little Chad-like figure here with a spear, and he's throwing the spear down at this huge stag. Meanwhile, there's two canine beasts running down, perhaps hounds, part of a hunting scene, in the hunting down of a stag juxtaposed on the other side is this big, scary serpent beast that's all wrapped up with tendrils and so on. Here's another couple of fragments, clearly, perhaps less effectively executed versions of the same thing. And you see this guy has another distinctive feature, this very cone-headed profile, which has been interpreted as rather as, of course, I always joke with my students, this must be some kind of alien. And now I've said it, that'll go in the papers. Must be some kind of alien. This couldn't possibly be a human. I can see that on some TV channel. No, I'm being serious. These are probably, this is headdress. This is helmet. A helmet with a nose guard. And you can see the nose guard distinctively coming down between the eyes. And these individuals, therefore, are martial figures. He's got a spear on one side. And there's various poorly rendered weapons around this individual too. But the most famous and well reproduced of these is our character here that I showed you on the opening slide. And the first point to say is this is a Christian monument. So here's the cross, and here's the panel with the warrior. And there's a close-up of the warrior. And there's a number of elements to this that are worth mentioning in some more detail. Oh, but we have here a shield at the top. See that? It's not exactly to scale. If you think about the likely size of an early medieval shield by the 10th, 11th centuries, but it is a circle with a boss in the middle. You have a spear. You have an axe, a long axe, a bearded axe. You have a sword. And the other weapon that you don't notice as quickly is that sitting across his lap, horizontally, is a sax, a small, one-sided, bladed, stabbing sword. There's a number of other features that are discussed about this monument. And Jim Lang made the point that this is he's not his legs are so short, probably because it's a very poor attempt to depict someone seated, and he's actually sitting down, and that these might be the finials of a chair, a high back chair in which he's seated. So rather than a standing warrior with some a sack somehow miraculously balancing, he's actually seated with the blade across in a sheath across his waist. The thing between his legs surprisingly escapes attention, and I shall move on from it at the moment. But there are also some other features here, which, you know, you could say, well, that's just simply the leftover space from where they had to carve the spearhead. Or is that was there once, before it was worn and damaged, an attempt to imply some other features behind the figure? Not very, you know, sophisticated carving compared with what we saw at Rothwell, but still, taken for its time, taken for the 10th century, an effective depiction of a series of implements with a male figure, with a nose guard, a helmet, and one could almost imagine a beard if you're so inclined. Now, the point that's been made by scholars is that this is not a depiction of a pagan weapon burial. This is not, though it's tempting to imagine this is a representation of someone lying in a grave surrounded by grave goods, this is a Christian monument, and the artifacts are doing something else. And if it is a seated figure, this is therefore a lord, not just any warrior or farmer who happened to have a few weapons to hand. This is a depiction of someone of status. This is a depiction of someone who sits on a high seat, a gift stall within his hall. Therefore, this is about authority, power, and a landed estate-owning magnate, rather than necessarily about warrior status. So this isn't really a warrior at all. This is about lordship. In addition to that, therefore, the context of understanding these weapons is imagining halls, maybe not as grand as this one from Lyra in Denmark, one of the larger Viking-Age halls excavated by archaeologists, but to make the point that this is therefore a depiction of a lord on his high seat that would not have been positioned anywhere. It would have been positioned in one particular context, and that's the context that's the centre of early medieval social and political life, as well as religious life in many ways in the pagan period, the hall. And so what you're probably looking at here is a depiction not of a burial with grave goods, but of a lord in his hall presiding over that space. And if we think about that, then the artifacts are presumably part of his treasury, part of his, a symbol, not of his personal ability to wield them, which would have been still key for early medieval lords. You couldn't be a lord if you couldn't wield these weapons. But also his bodily integrity, and also his role in, as a lord, in gift giving. And I wonder whether it is coincidental that his right hand seems to be palm outwards, and whether that is a gesture that is symbolising giving, while his left hand rests on the axe. But it's not that straightforward, because, of course, in this period, supposedly pagan furnished burials are taking place. And these are some photographs I took yesterday in your wonderful Manx Museum. So here are some of the most famous, from the whole of the Viking world, furnished burials of the 10th century that you've had excavated on the island. And just to make the point that I'm not making a direct parallel, but I'm making the point that weapon assemblages were selected out and interred with particular adult male individuals in the 10th century world. And this was part of funerary theatre. This is part of an elaborate process of in which mourners articulate the identity of the dead person and install them in the landscape and often prominent mounds to be remembered. And in that regard, not that the Middleton sculpture is a representation of a furnished grave, but in the sense that the assemblage of weapons promotes memory through time, this is analogous. So it's not, I'm not saying that that is a representation of a grave, but there is a connection to the burial world and furnished, and the role of these artifacts that may be heirlooms, may have been given and received down the generations, that a lord would accumulate but then give out weapons, spears, armour, and so on, and swords in particular, and the depiction on the stone. So it's about projecting the memory of that individual. And we also have to remember that many furnished burials of the 10th century, this from further away, of course, this is from eastern Sweden, but and this is an artist's reconstruction in plan and section of two individuals who are thought to have been buried, a man and a woman, sitting on a chair with sacrificed horses and a range of artifacts and maybe even a spear thrown over the bodies, dedicating them to the gods. My point here is to simply say that the hall and the grave were not synonymous, but they were related in the 10th century world, in 10th century thinking. They were related because the grave was an architectural space where the dead could reside. And from later sources, such as the sagas, we have hints that, at least in folk memory, the dead were regarded as inhabitants of their graves. So I wonder whether, I'm not again saying that the Middleton sculpture is a pagan representation of a furnished grave, but it's coming from a world in which the dead are depicted with the items that denoted their status and projected their memory. And indeed, this is a slide from a just published article of mine, that I've suggested in the 10th century, there were a whole range of different scaled architectural spaces in which elite personhood was conveyed, that straddled the Christian and the pagan, that came from the halls and the boathouses, the smithies and the temples, down to the tents and the tombs and the caskets and the reliquies that were circulating around the Viking world, and also right the way down to the what I call architectonic small artifacts. Artifacts that implied the bowed walls and ridges of halls in their form, whether it was overt and you have miniature representations of buildings on some amulets, or it's more covert, it's implied rather than an actual building in its precise forms. And what I suggested is that if you are depicting a space in which the living and the dead can both be imagined as residing, it's the hall and various micro versions of it circulating in elite, sacred and secular artifacts. So an architectonic network of objects. And it's that material context that helps us understand why this depiction is crude and yet so powerful, because it shows a set of weapons on display. It's not simply saying this is a person who could use those weapons, this is a person who could mobilise those weapons, could receive them, could give them away, could oil the wheels of social and political life through the exchange of such martial implements. It's not simply about martial ability, it's about martial mechanisms of a society dominated by a warrior elite. He's postured, seated, but perhaps also proffering. Is there hints of a tapestry or some other elaborate features behind him? Is he gesturing? And what's between his legs? Is that also part of his lordly potency? Who knows? But he's active. He's not sitting idly. To sit in the early Middle Ages is to be powerful. It's not to be a passive. Being seated is potent agency, the ability to control the room, the space, and to dominate that society. So what we're seeing here is very simple at one level. It's a depiction of a man with weapons, but it's actually trying to project the memory, maybe of a person, maybe of people, we don't know, maybe the dead man himself, under which his body was interred, we don't know, but it's projecting an idealised version of lordly status as a seated, weaponed figure, someone who's in control of the circulation of those weapons. But most importantly of all, I think, is he's watching you. And his eyes are clear and striking, and he's looking out at you. This is not just a depiction, this is a powerful force to be reckoned with as you approach this grave. And I wonder whether that witnessing presence is important. The difference in the eye size has not been noted, and it may be just because of bad carving. It may be because the artist is trying to do a really rubbish version of three-dimensional figural art that we find on earlier depictions of angels and ecclesiastical figures, such as the Lichfield angel, Gabriel. Or is there an allusion to a pre-Christian world there, and the one-eyed Odin? That would be an idea that I haven't seen circulating, but Neil Price and Paul Mortimer have suggested from a range of sources across the northern world from the 6th century onwards, the one-eyed nature of Odin was played with in a range of different media and art styles. Could even the Middleton warrior or lord be gaining that kind of supernatural sight through his depiction of a slight bias in the eyes? But of course that's played juxtaposed against the other side of the monument, which has this wonderful serpent. And this is, if you don't think the eyes of that guy are particularly scary, I would challenge you not to find yourself a little unnerved by the stare of this scary beastie. And it's a serpent. There's his eyes. He's got a beak, which is closed. He's got a bound mouth. His front arm is like going to square around the top of his head, and he's bound again, tethered there. And the worm or dragon's tail is also bound. And you can see along the base here that the knots where he's tied up. So this is a serpent who's having a bit of a contorted time of it. It's a powerful, most fearsome mythological beast, but bound and bound up. And this very much links to the work of Victoria Thompson, who's discussed this very stone in terms of her broader arguments about Anglo-Saxon Christian understandings of the body as and the soul in death, and their dynamic relationship in relation to the grave. And I don't want to crudely paraphrase her ideas too much, but to say that this idea of a threatening and yet bound worm may be a metaphor for Christian salvation, saved from evil, that you depict the devil, but as a bound and curtailed force. Now, whether this worm is a representation of evil, or whether this is a representation of a bound beast that is serving to protect the stone, its gazing eyes, perhaps once picked out by a different colour, are a nice juxtaposition to the Middleton warrior. And I would also make the point that the archaeology provides a material context for this, because we now have increasing archaeological evidence that the late Anglo-Saxon world was a place where if you trespassed against the order, you were not only killed, you were killed in a public and vicious fashion. And archaeological evidence for execution cemeteries, through the work of particularly Andrew Reynolds, but also others including Dawn Handley and Joe Buckbury and Sarah Semple, has revealed the varied and complex ways in which the executed dead were treated. These are some of the sand bodies from Sutton Hoo in Suffolk. And while these aren't precisely dated, it's quite clear these people, and the bones didn't survive, so we can't tell from the wounds. It's quite clear from the postures in the graves, from the careful excavation of the soil stains, that these individuals died in horrible fashions. Some of them had lost their heads, some of them were bound up when they were dumped in the grave. And I cannot but notice a parallel with our bound serpent here. The idea of this is a bound force, consigned to the grave. This is the famous, only recently published, Dorset Ridgeway at Weymouth, Ridgeway Hill near Weymouth burial, where these skeletons seem to be Scandinavians, dating to the early 11th century, and they seem to be a rather unsuccessful group of Scandinavian raiders, probably one ship's worth, who were all rounded up, stripped naked, and then had their heads cut off. And we have place name evidence and charter-bound evidence of places of killing and places of heathen burial on the borders of territories. And clearly two-post gallows were being constructed here and people were being disposed of here. And the point is, by doing so, you weren't forgetting these miscreants. You were remembering them in an overt fashion. You're promoting the memory of the people who could pass the judgments and consign these individuals to death. And so what this tells us about Middleton, I think, is quite interesting, because on the two sides of this stone, you have the ideal of the Lord seated in his hall, in control of his world, free with his hands to give and receive, to assert justice, and with the weapons that denote his status and his retinue, juxtaposed with the bound serpent, bound, pinned, and yet both are looking out at you with the same eyes. And I think that is a crude but powerful juxtaposition of punishment and gift-giving as the opposite ends of the social spectrum of lordly power. And both are fixed watches, engaging anyone who approaches this monument with their state of being, you know, making you look back at them and engage with the stories that might have been told about them. We don't know if this is a portrait of a single individual. We don't know the exact range of associations of this particular serpent. Serpents have many different statuses in the early medieval mind and practice, but I think that juxtaposition is a powerful one, and one to do with the state of the living and the fate imagined for the soul. That's my first case study for you. How we can look to the broader archaeological context of halls, graves and execution victims to understand how we can interpret these stones and the gazes of the individuals upon them. I want to take you though to a second stone. And this is at Minor Quivan. And here I want to look less at the material context but the landscape context. Now this is a really exciting monument that rarely appears in the literature. It's now been published by Nancy Edwards in the Welsh Corpus, and it sits in Flintshire in the far north-east corner of Wales, so actually probably one of the closest parts of the mainland island of Britain to where we are today. And it's important because it seems to be in its original location. It's called Quivenstone. It's a circle-headed cross. It's two stones, a crosshead and shaft, sitting in the original base. It's sandstone. It's in situ since at least 1388. So I think we can assume it's probably in its original location. It's 3.4 metres high, and Nancy Edwards, 2013, dates this to the mid to late 10th century. The railings are more recent. Slightly lighter pictures. I'll show you gloomy pictures to start. Lighter pictures. To show you what it looks like in sunlight. And this is a striking landmark. It has a distinctive orientation to it. Like most early medieval stones, the front and the back are not the same. They're different. They're very distinctive. the form shared is it's a distinctive shape, but it's also a distinctive orientation to it. It would have originally been coloured and lustered. It would have had gems set into it, from the holes around the cross. But it also has these huge panels of abstract ornamentation that are striking and memorable. And presumably this plaitwork and fretwork would have originally been painted. But it also has some rather enigmatic warriors on it. And one beastie that gets called an equine, a horse, but I wonder whether it's something else. Now, it's a landmark even if it wasn't decorated, painted, with elaborate forms. This shows some pictures in shadow, in fog and in sunlight to make the point. This is a prominent monument regardless of what's daubed on it. And the front and the back to show you how striking it would have been when painted. You can only imagine. We can do our own little colouring charts and make it up. But on the east side, we have this crazy guy. And I don't know how well you're going to see this because it's not easy to see. These are two versions in different shading. I don't know if the lights, Katrina, can be lowered a little bit to help with the looking people. Yeah, maybe this will help. I'll take you through it anyway. So there's a figure, and he seems to have something between his legs. So it's been called a male figure by Nancy. She's very clear on these matters. But he's holding an axe, a bearded axe. Look at that big bladed axe. He's got a... if we can call him a he, he's got a spear or a staff. He's also got a sword or sax at his waist. And he's got a serpent winding around his body. I can see the same thing there, the serpent winding around. And he's set with these scroll work. We don't know what this is. It's been assumed this is related to some Norse mythological scene, and it might as well be, because I have nothing else to suggest it, who it is, but it is another distinctive martial figure. Oh, it's a bigger pardon. Now, is this pagan on a Christian monument? This is a cross. This is a cross. Is it supposed to be a pagan figure? Is it a Christian warrior? Who is it? Is it a manly depiction of the Lord who commissioned the monument? Is it, could it even be the saint himself, St. Quivan, St. Kevin? This is a derivation of the Irish St. Kevin. You know, you can make up all sorts of different suggestions about who this figure might be, and I can't answer that. All I will tell you is that you approach this cross from the east and you're facing a really scary guy who's in the middle of a battle, presumably, with a serpent. Now, there's another warrior figure. On the narrow south side, there's this other dude. And he's really poorly preserved, but his stance isn't dissimilar from the Middleton figure. He's got a sword across his waist. His legs are very unclear, but that's why I've dawed them in there. And his arms are in a sort of crossed over position. He's also got a serpent coming up between his legs. And it's not too clear there. I'll show you a picture later on. Here we are. Here he is over here. There he is. There's his arms. There's his waist. And between his legs, he comes up this serpent's head. And again, something else between the legs. And that's definitely part of a serpentine body that's coming around here. So an individual threatened from below by a serpent. But below him, this is a bit below the stone, there's what Nancy Edwards called possibly a key. I think these are two figures who are facing each other, but it really isn't clear. And below that again is this beastie here, which has been interpreted in Norse mythological terms as Sigurd's horse Grani with the treasure. But I can't buy that. I don't know what it might be. I have a suggestion of what it might be, but whatever it is, it's a large beast that looks so far removed from what a horse should be, that but possibly closer to what a hound or a wolf might be, with large lips. And I'm not saying this is an effectively executed wolf or hound, but it's a four-legged mammalian, if that's the broadest way of saying it, but it's got things between its legs that are not at all clear. And so that's another intriguing element to this monument that I've got a suggestion for, because there's very few four-legged mammalians with things between their legs that I can think of from early medieval art, other than the she-wolf that looks after, nurtures Romulus and Remus, the mythological figures of founders of Rome, which is depicted throughout early medieval art in a range of contexts that depicts the origins of the church and the protection of the church. And here on the 8th century, two centuries earlier than we think of here, Frank's casket. This is a whalebone casket, and you know, amazing, rich decoration. A far cry, you might think, from this rather rubbish depiction here. But you have to remember, this has been exposed for over 1,000 years of being outside in the world landscape, and you know, it could be something else. But I suspect, I wonder whether this is this might be heads of Romulus and Remus between the feet of the she-wolf. Now, that's just a suggestion, but if it is, it throws into doubt that this is all about Norse mythology, and that it might be as much to do with the protection of the church, the mobilisation of weapons and lordly power, and also the suckling of the she-wolf being a metaphor for the protection of space by holy power. And this takes us to the regional context of this monument, because this monument is in an area of Scandinavian settlement and influence. This is where Whitford is, and this is right on the Wirral. We have place name evidence of, and this is from Nancy Edwards, and this is from David Griffiths' work, showing you the areas where we have sculpture, place names, and other artifacts and finds that hint at a Scandinavian presence. And here's Mynach Gwyvan, the Cross of Quiven, right in this area near Dyserth. On the Dee, at the tip of the Dee estuary. So fine, I'm happy to have a Scandinavian influence here, but this is all. If we look at the micro architecture of this area, this is also an area linked to the linear earthworks of Offa's and Watts Dyke in the 8th and 9th century. This is an area linked to Chester, linked to a holy centre from at least the 7th century AD. This is an area connected into the Irish Sea world, including links to Man. This isn't simply about Viking influence. This is part of a Christian set of kingdoms. The Welsh kingdoms, the Northumbrian kingdom is here, the Mercians are here, predating that Viking intervention. And if we look at the local context, David Griffith argues that we may be looking at a cross that's in the centre of an enclosure that's picked out on geophysical survey, set within a landscape of prehistoric burial mounds, which would be an appropriate place for an assembly, a place where people gathered. And some work with one of my students, Aria, we presented this at the Theoretical Archaeology Group conference last year. She did some preliminary GIS analysis, just to make the point that Mynach Gwyvan is actually sitting in a basin next to some prehistoric dikes called the Whitford Dikes, and between two principal early churches at Whitford to the east and Dyserth to the west. And that this area may have been on, Mynach Gwyvan sits on a major route across this upland landscape. And the view sheds of it are very contained. You can't, so when you're there, you feel you're in an enclosed private landscape. But you'd only need to put two or three people on the hills around here to dominate and control approach to it. An appropriate place for an assembly is the equivalent, the Flinch's equivalent of Tingwock, in terms of it's a place surrounded by hills on major routes across the Isle of Man, but not by the sea. You're safe from, you have chance of warning of anyone approaching you. And so what we think is going on here is that it's on a key route of movement across an upland landscape. It may be a site of assembly, and therefore these warriors and these other figures may be evoking in the art the protection of the saint or the lord. So very different monuments, Middleton and Mynach Gwyvan, but the art is doing something, and we can understand the art better by thinking about its context of use. I haven't got all the answers, but I've got a couple of suggestions there of how we can think about those warrior figures, not only representations of particular individuals, but how it may have impacted on those attending there. If 100 or 1,000 people are assembling at Mynach Gwyvan, they're seeing that art, they're thinking about the protection afforded to them at the place of assembly through the representation of either legendary figures or biblical figures or saintly figures or the Lord who commissioned the stone. Okay, I'm going to take you away from warriors of a human form to beastly warriors as my third and final case study, which I'll wrap up in 5 minutes. Now, I'm going to take you back across the Pennines to Brompton and the famous hogback stones. Now, hogback stones, we're moving away from crosses to recumbent gravestones. And I've published three papers on these in the last 18 months. And I've expressed some arguments in those articles about what I think about these hogback stones. I'm not the only one working on hogbacks, and there's a number of other scholars who are active in researching these recumbent gravestones of the 10th and early 11th centuries. This is the traditional distribution of them, which has outliers as far north as Shetland and some possible ones in Cornwall and in Hampshire at Winchester, the royal capital of the West Saxons. But the main concentration of monuments that get called hogbacks sit in southern Scotland and northern England. We haven't got any from the Isle of Man, although maybe you could go out and dig one up for me, that'd be lovely. Now, they're very varied monuments, and some suggest that they're not really a category of monument at all, and I have a lot of sympathy with that view. But as a simple term, hogback still gets used to describe a series of recumbent grey slabs, some of which have end beasts, bears or dragon-like forms that frame the monument. And these take us back to the idea of halls in miniature. This is an architectonic space to protect the tomb of the dead, and presumably landed martial elites of the same kind who are raising the Middleton Stone and raising the Minaquevan Cross. These are the most famous of the hogbacks. These are of Brompton in Yorkshire. Each one is different, and they're all of different quality of execution and different styles, with different elaborate patterns down their sides. Some have hints of tegulated roofs, like canopies, wooden tiles of roofs. And in these cases, from Brompton, you have four-legged or two-legged, the top halves of bears grasping their ends. And these bears have been the focus of a lot of different interpretations. Is this a hangover of pagan Scandinavia? The bear is therefore a symbol of Vikingness. Are these bears a Christian symbol of salvation or the protection of the church? Maybe a bit of all of these things, but I would like to point out in this talk the fact that these bears may be also watching warriors. They're sensing, grasping, clasping, tasting, watching forces that are protecting the tomb from intervention. These are solid grave covers, remember. Their primary practical role is in encasing and overlaying one or more graves. None have been found in situ, so we don't know exactly how they worked in the burial context. But the implication is that, as I've argued, these are like implying solid spaces. They're suggesting there's a space in there, but it's, of course, physically solid stone. So you can't get access to. And these bears, some of them huge, with their big claws, and the eyes would have been big too, but they've been worn out, but their ears, you can see, and their mouths are embracing, almost crushing, the ends of these canopied structures, and the lovely ears on these ones here. Nearby from Brompton, near to Brompton, Ingleby Arncliffe, we have one of the other classic examples. But there's another feature of these bears that I want to focus on, is that they are bound bears. They are tamed bears. They are muzzled. Oh, beg your pardon. So you've got up here Ingleby Arncliffe, you've got a clear line across the muzzle. These aren't wild bears, they are pet bears, or at least they're captive bears. This one on Brompton 24 is superb, and I put the Monimus reliquary, which is a Christian reliquary, as the name suggests, just to make the point that while this doesn't have end beasts, this idea of clasp that fix shut hall-like or architectonic artefacts is at play here. These bears hold their own muzzles shut. Their arms are coming up and holding them, just like the clasps on the Monimus reliquary. And indeed, these bears also have bound wrists. You can't see it on that side, you can see it on this side. So if you can see across there. And indeed, when I went to look at the Brompton hogbacks, I don't think anyone's published on this yet. Not only do that, this is a close-up of Brompton 17, unless I got my numbers mixed up, this is the muzzle, but all of them, either when originally carved or later, have chip marks across their paws, their wrists, if you like, or their forearms, suggesting that they're implying that the bears are bound. And again, I think what we're looking at here is another play on an idea of watching warriors. You're creating a watching beastly warriors in this case, who are looking over and protecting the grave. The bears could be symbols of Christian death and resurrection. Bears hibernate after all, and in early Christian thought, bears are seen as embodying the idea that you bring can be brought back to life. Bears are thought to lick their dead cubs into life at birth. They didn't give birth to live young, they licked them to life. That was one of the Christian myths, coming from Roman sources as well. Maybe that inspired this link of bears with Christian ideas of death and resurrection. But I think bears are also, or more significantly in a secular aristocratic context, metaphors for elite martial personhood and authority. The bear is the ultimate beast. It's the ultimate powerful beast. It embodies the warrior. And putting these on your tomb is like creating sensing sentinels for the soul. So creating a presence that you don't want to even face its watching gaze, let alone its bite or its hug. So in these three studies, I've tried to look at how this art is more than just representation, how it was supposed to impact on early medieval people, make them think about faith, but also make them think about laws and power, think about the identities of those being commemorated. And while we don't know who this is supposed to represent, who was underneath these hogbacks, and who this character is here with a snake coming up between his legs, we can at least start to look at the arts as an active force in early medieval societies, one that shaped people's understandings of their religion, but also shaped their understandings of how power was being enacted by the small landed elites that were controlling societies in the Viking Age. And that's where I'd like to leave it, please. Thank you very much. Thank you.